scatters when you play the beat, play the beat. A brainiac effects.
Now press rewind.
Welcome to Brain Squeeze Reactions. Myself, Mark Hector. What are we reacting to now? 2Pac interviews. Why? Because it's random Sunday reaction and that's when I do 2Pac interviews? Hello! I want to dig into an interview with the man himself. And the one that I've picked out today is 2Pac Shakur interviewed by host Tanya Hart in 1992. It says it's rare, but as we know with YouTube, that means fuck all, so it might not be rare, but what I am hoping is to pick out those ones that potentially people haven't seen before. I certainly haven't seen it, but I want to try and make sure that people watching this can enjoy this. Now, I will be pausing, and we will be talking about it. So for the fucking idiots in the comment that don't understand that, okay, it means pausing in between discussions and having a chat about it. If you don't like that, haters, fuck off. Speaking of haters, comment section is for love, it's not for hate. Haters, go fuck yourself. Before we jump into this, 2Pac writ a poetry book at 19, The Rose That Grew From The Concrete. So throughout the month of June, I've been taking random poems from this and reading them out. Some people have read this book, some people haven't. So it's a nice thing to do throughout June. And plus, I'm enjoying the poems that come from this. So we just literally do this. Stop. Ah, it's got a bit of paper in. That just tells me I've already done it. Hey. We'll go with there. So this says, "So I Say Goodbye. I'm going into this not knowing what I'll find, but I've decided to follow my heart and abandon my mind. Fuck. And if there be a pain, I know that at least I gave my all. And it's better to have loved and lost than to not love at all. Fuck. In the morning, I may wake to smile or maybe to cry. But first to those of my past, I must say goodbye." Fucking 19. I was going to say 20. I added a year. 19. Whew. Anyways, let's jump into this. 2Pac interview by host Tanya Hart in 92. Let's fucking go. Oh, I pushed it forward a little bit because there was some guff at the beginning, so I'm not sure what the fuck that was all about, just so it starts right into the interview.
Oh, yes. Please welcome a very streetwise young man who wants to make a difference for all black people. How are you? Wow. 2Pac Shakur, welcome to our show.
Thank you.
Boy, you know, I've got to tell you, I've heard about your story, have listened to many of the accounts of what happened to you as a young man. And looking at the movie Juice, you know, which is a powerful story, but Juice seems like a Sunday school picnic after hearing about your life, to tell you the truth,
yes,
brother.
Lord.
It really does. In retrospect, how would you say that your life has been? What would you say about your life? How would you define it?
I would say it's been like a test on my faith. You know what I'm saying? You know how, I guess his name was Job in the Bible, who God just did all of this crazy stuff to him just to make sure his faith was straight. And that's how it was. It made me, if I didn't have all of this stuff, I don't think that my feet would have been so firm to where I could stand up for anything, you know, and I would be less ready to deal with what's out there.
Yeah. So let's talk a little bit about what happened to you when you were growing up. Your parents were in the Black Panther Party. Mm-hmm. That was kind of like their job.
Yeah, it was. My mother was in the Black Panther Party. She was like at a high position, which was like unheard of, because of course there was sexism even in the Panthers. So, and my stepfather at the time, Matu Shakur, he was also like a well-known like revolutionary. True. All of my roots to the struggle are real deep. And then my godfather, Geronimo Pratt, you know, he was like, had a top official rank position with the Panthers on the West Coast.
Right. And we just mentioned he's, of course, serving a life sentence right now. Yeah. Your mom.
That's crazy. His bloodline is fucking strong for the Black Panthers. Strong. And let's not forget what he said at the beginning, where he said he's like Job. I don't remember that from the Bible. I'm removed from that now, is the politest way I can put that. But he's saying Job having everything thrown at him just to test his faith. You gotta say, he ain't far from the truth with that. I mean, what more could you throw at this dude? But it's just hearing all these people that are an influence in his life, that's fucking crazy. That's mad. And to say from then up until the age of 25, it's no wonder he had so much fucking power in his words, because that education, that's second to none. I've only just started the Black Panther journey, so there's a lot of doors to unlock on that. But fuck me.
The Panthers on the West Coast.
Right. We just mentioned he's, of course, serving a life sentence right now. Yeah. Your mom was carrying you when she went to jail the first time. That's a very interesting story in itself. What happened to her? Why was she in jail?
Because like, you know, there's racism. So when the Panthers hit, the government panicked, and they had a thing called a COINTELPRO, and they felt like the Panthers were detrimental to American society, so they raided every Panthers house, especially the ones who they felt like could do the most damage as an orator. Mm-hmm. So my mother was 9 months pregnant, no, 7 months pregnant. Mm. They put a match to the door and said, fire, fire. And, you know, it's like 5 a.m. So my mother opened the door and they just burst in, put a shotgun to her pregnant belly.
Oh, fucking animals, man. Okay, so this COINTEL, now this is something that I'm every time I hear it, don't get frustrated. I know you got to remember, it's only the third time that I've been talking about it. The first time I heard it on the Asata thing, and then I was educated. The second time, which was on a previous reaction that I did. I can't remember if it was in a song where it was brought up, and then yourselves are putting it in there. But the COINTEL is basically a law that was put in place to crack down on any political movements that involved black parties. Have I got that? I got that right. And it was fucking venomous. And you just heard it there, putting a match to the fucking door to say it's on fire, then putting a gun to a pregnant lady's belly. The fuck are you doing? And that is why I'm jumping into some of that Black Panther history to understand more about that. But just the way you articulated that went through me. I did not like that at all.
They put a match to the door and said, fire, fire. And, you know, it's like 5 a.m. So my mother opened the door and they just burst in, put a shotgun to her pregnant belly and put a gun to her head and said, don't move. Bye, bye, bye. They said, you're under arrest. They treated them like less than human. This is a pregnant woman.
What do you think your parents were trying to accomplish in those days and with the movement?
I like her questions, by the way. For people new to this channel, we normally get shitty fucking interviews. That Karen fucking whatever her name is. Old prison warden K. I forgot her name because I don't care.
What do you think your parents were trying to accomplish in those days and with the movement?
I think that my mother, like a lot of people, like a lot of them, like Fred Hampton, Mark Clark, Harriet Tubman, they felt like they were laying tracks for the generation to come. I think my mother knew that freedom wouldn't come in her lifetime, just like I know that it won't come in mine. Hmm. But it's a matter of either we stay like this or somebody sacrifices. Somebody laid a track so we don't stay in a 360-degree deadly circle. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Somebody has to break out and risk, you know, losing everything and being poor and getting beat down. But somebody has to do something.
The best part of the story, I guess, is that your mother actually beat this rap.
Ooh.
Served as her own attorney?
Her own attorney, never been to law school. She was facing 300 and something odd years. One black woman pregnant beat the case. That just goes to show you the strength of a black woman and the strength of the oppressed.
What does it do to a young man like yourself, though, when all of your heroes, your mother, your father, whom has passed away, he was incarcerated as well.
Yes, Lord.
Your godfather, all of your heroes have been to jail.
And they weren't all Panthers. My stepfather was a Panther. My father was a gangster, a straight up ignorant, you know, hustler. Mm-hmm. But he loved the fact that the Panthers, my mother told me is that it was a one night stand. But he loved the fact that the Panthers would go to jail and wouldn't snitch. Mm-hmm. They were true to each other, you know, as women, it was men. And that was a one night stand. That's how I came to be, you know, out of the love for black people. So that's how I gotta live, and that's how I have to die. And that's how my music has to be, and my acting, and my producing, and my interviews, everything has to be for the love of black people.
This dude speaks in fucking quotes, okay? In the past, like, 3 minutes of him talking, the stuff coming out of him is literally giving me goosebumps when I'm hearing about, when he said about that 360, someone's got to take the step out and lose everything in order to gain something. Something along those lines he said. It fucking revolutionary.
And my producing and my interviews, everything has to be for the love of black people.
Yeah. Mm. We were talking about that earlier, just about, I mean, for 20 years old, I have to tell you, you have quite a head on your shoulders. You do. And you seem to be very targeted. We were talking about some of the other people in this business that you feel don't have a love for their own people. Not really. We were talking about, you know, shall we name the name?
We sure shall. We were talking about Spike Lee, Arsenio Hall, Eddie Murphy, and the rest of them. Michael Jackson, Randy Jackson, Janet Jackson, Paula Abdul, all of them. She wants to not be black, but wants to sell to black folks. I don't appreciate that.
Okay.
I don't appreciate her
What am I missing here? What am I missing here, man? Fucking reeling off names like that. Michael Jackson, Janet Jackson, Paula Abdul. That was in the Eminem song the other day. This is the only way I know Paula Abdul. Apparently taking a cock to the back of her throat to hit her tonsils. Eminem words, not mine, just to be very clear on that. What? Spike Lee is another name? Someone needs to fill me in on that.
She wants to not be black, but wants to sell to black folks. I don't appreciate that.
Okay.
I don't appreciate her going out of her way to say she's not black.
We're going to talk about that right after this. Stay with us. Mm. Piece called Brenda's Got a Baby from Tupac's latest Track. Album. That's your own solo
latest
album, isn't it?
Tupac.
Yes. Tupacalypse Now.
Powerful, powerful stuff. I want to talk about that and some of your other titles, but before we do, we cannot let go what we were talking about this last
segment. We got to get back to that,
yes, honey.
Man.
Yes.
Okay.
Now, you were just talking
about
how you feel that Arsenio and Eddie and who else did you name there? Spike Lee and some
Spike
other people?
Lee,
just
Paul
really?
Michael Jackson.
Before I say it, let me say it like this. These are people who, besides Paul Abdul, these are people who I looked up to.
Yes,
Arsenio,
we all do.
Spike and Eddie Murphy. This is the only reason I'm saying this, because I love them and I want them to check
well,
themselves.
Well, good, because I want
That's
them,
it.
Want to
I don't
make
want
that
it,
clear.
I'm not out just, I know that people hate to see black folks arguing. It's not like that. It's just me, a young man, asking my role models to, you know, explain.
So what?
How
what,
could you
what is
be down for black
folks?
Okay, now Spike Lee, first of all, Ernest Dickerson is his cinematographer, did every picture he ever made. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
He's responsible for his success. Let me tell it.
Mm-hmm.
So, Ernest Dickerson does his first solo movie, a black film. Right. I feel as though, and supporting black film is not just about going to the premiere. It's not about just going to buy tickets to see Jungle Fever. It's about, you know, supporting black film, black actors, black directors. We never saw Spike Lee. I expected, you know what I'm saying, his
cinematography. He never came to the set?
Just one day, I just wanted him to come and go, good luck. Just, you know, while he's riding in a limo, good luck. You know what I'm saying, on his way to Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm.
Good luck, you know, young black male. You're going, he knows what we had to go through. You know, he knew about all of that. He knew everything we was going to have to face.
And fair comments.
No solidarity. You know what I'm saying? So therefore, people need to know. All the ghetto people that want to know Spike is down, no, he ain't down. Not
Ooh,
to-
fucking hell. Fuck, man. He didn't hold back in this one. He's got
people
a point,
need to
though.
Know. All the ghetto people that want to know Spike is down, no, he ain't down. Not to me. He need to check himself. Because you need to stop disrespecting black women in his films.
In what way?
In every film, Jungle Fever, every film he ever had, it's got to be a love scene. You know what I'm saying? It's got to be where a black man is slamming into a black woman or whatever. You know what I'm saying? And that ain't cool. That's not how he's supposed to be representing us as a whole, because he's going to forget where he came from. And he didn't come from Brooklyn. He came from a woman.
Don't you think it's important, though, that, I mean, whatever you say about Spike, he's got a lot of us working. Does that matter?
That doesn't mean nothing. That don't mean nothing. Dope dealers got a lot of us working. That don't mean nothing. You know what I'm saying? You can't compromise our culture and our principles just to put us to work, just to make us appeal to the masses.
That whole culture piece there. And what he's saying, did you notice his whole demeanor has gone in this fucking Tupac focus mode? Where he's saying dope dealers are similar to that when he's talking about it, but he's talking culture.
Of us working. That don't mean nothing. You know what I'm saying? You can't compromise our culture and our principles just to put us to work, just to make us appeal to the masses.
Mm-hmm.
Because revolutionaries and freedom never came easy. You know what I'm saying? And he knows he has a lot of work. So if he's up there and it's easy, he should know something is not right.
Yeah.
And something's not right, buddy. And Eddie Murphy, with all that dough he's making, he hasn't done nothing for us.
He does a lot of charity.
What charity doesn't get to the ghetto. Mm-hmm. Everybody knows that. Everybody who ever came out the ghetto knows they never saw any charity.
They don't see the charity benefits.
No, that goes
that we
for
all
the
go
suburban
to.
Black people. You know what I'm saying? The middle class black folks who don't need the money. They get the charity. Because how can a white person give the money to the ghetto and they scared to go to the ghetto?
Yeah, very good point. Very good.
So
very
why
good
would
point.
They? I don't understand why would they do that to us? Eddie Murphy, knowing he built his career on making black folks laugh, he built his career off black humor, off us. We was the loudest laughing at him. We was the loudest clappers. The most we paid the most to see his concerts was there, supported him, and he deserted us.
You know what I'd love to do? I'd like to get you, Eddie, and Arsenio, and Spike. We'll have to get a roundtable discussion going. So
I mean, yeah, if you want to see one of them go fucking through it, I mean, did you not see the fucking, the annoyance that was coming from Tupac? That was coming from his fucking soul as he was talking there. You could feel every word he was saying there and his belief that went behind it. His whole point about don't fucking smoke screen me with charity bollocks, because that doesn't make it to the ghetto. That only goes middle class and no further. And he's saying no white man's going to be walking to the ghetto to drop off a check because they're too scared to. Nah, fucking hell. What was it, 20? 20 and he's talking this? Fuck.
We can hear what they have. Because I'd like to hear them respond.
The reason I want to say this on TV is because I want them to check themselves. I want them to hear this young black male checking them and then check themselves. It's not a diss thing.
Let me talk a little bit about Juice, because I saw the movie. I have to ask you honestly, I want you to help me understand this, because it's a movie, young black men coming of age, and you are the main perpetrator. You're the star of this film. And so you're killing your buddies, your friends. Now, we know this is a script and this is not really Tupac. But I have to ask you, is there anything that you could honestly say that you're proud of in this film?
Yes. It's everything I'm proud of in the film. Mm-hmm.
Like
I love that. I feel right now, and any black male can identify that, I could truly pass off. I could die. And I've left a mark. And for a white person, that might be something. So why would he say that? But for a black person in today's society, where we're not promised to live to 21, at 20 years old, I did a feature film and I did a good job, a job where I can be proud of myself.
You can be proud of yourself.
Therefore, I feel like.
But didn't you say, Tupac, that you felt like that you were pimped because of the storyline?
Oh, yes. I feel like I was pimped because out of all of that, I'm going to tell everybody, 15 G's. Mm-hmm. The government took half of that. And out of all of it, out of this story about young black males, old white folks gonna get paid.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But it's cool because I got a chance to speak to young black males all over the country.
But what is
I got a chance to be recognized.
What is the message?
Finished.
Because
don't
I gotta
it.
Tell you, I was up.
Okay. I started saying that you're asking good questions. Now you're getting on my fucking tits. Okay? Stop trying to fucking talk over him. So this is a Juiced film that I haven't seen yet, but there's a reason why. Would the video have come out yet? Yeah, it should have if I've made it in time. You'll understand what I'm talking about if you've seen it. There's a video of Coming Soon. It's basically, if you haven't watched the Coming Soon video, it's either you haven't watched it or I haven't released it yet. But when it comes out, anyway, it doesn't matter. So I need to really watch this. I need to watch this video. But it'd be interesting. I'm glad I've watched this before I've seen the Juice film so I can give a good analogy of where she's trying to go with this. What Puck is trying to say there, he's trying to say that for a person who's 20, when the average age is 21, he's not seeing past it, especially in the areas that he's saying he's from, based on the culture, he's saying he's proud of it because he's in a feature film. I know what she's about to say is obviously talking about how he's interpreted, because I just heard that she said that he kills black people in it, or they're killing each other, and that's what it's portraying with guns and stuff like that. So I know where she's going with this, and I know she's about to go there, but you got to understand what he's saying is that I am 20 and I'm in a feature film and I'm a young black male. You know, that doesn't happen often. And he's saying he did a good job, and good for him, man. There's nothing wrong with saying that you're good. There's nothing wrong with that. It's called transcendence of motivation, man. More people should fucking do it. And I know where she's digging into now, so she's starting to fucking annoy me a little bit, but it's okay. I'm going to woosah. Okay, but the part that he was saying about the 15 G's, really? That's all he got paid? And then government tax on top of that? So he walked away with what? Like 10 grand? That's unbelievable.
I'm going to tell everybody, 15 G's. Mm-hmm. The government took half of that. And out of this story about young black males,
this bit here.
Old white folks going to get paid.
Story about young black males, white folks are getting paid. Again, it goes back to that. It's no wonder there's frustration in the culture. I'm frustrated for people. Do you know what I mean? I'm starting to understand this and educating. It's fucking me off.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But it's cool because I got a chance to speak to young black males all over the country.
But what is the message?
I got a chance to be recognized.
What is the message? Because I got to tell you, I was upset. I was disturbed. And I thought you all did a good job. And I know Ernest did a good job. And I'm not saying people didn't do a good job, but I've seen the story. I see too many young black men killing each other. Why do I need to see that again?
This is what it's about. This is what it is. Usually, those, I don't know about the other stories about young black men, but this was a black man, a good black man, Ernest Dickinson, who put his money where his mouth was. You will never hear me checking Ernest, because he gave four unknown actors a chance to prove that the young black male can accomplish anything. He didn't go through the call. He didn't go through all of the black looking actors. He went and got black actors. Us and the other three actors. No matter what the movie was saying, it's a movie.
Listen to what you're saying.
In terms of Terminator. I think that we do have a lot to accomplish, but we have to pace ourselves because, you know, in one movie, we can't explain the plight. We can't save black America. We got to start somewhere. And I don't know about anything else, but this, to me, was the start.
What was the message, though?
No. Okay. The point he's trying to say, he's not answering because... You were telling me this as well. He knows what she's doing. He's not an idiot. He knows she's trying to dig a hole, so he's not biting, or I hope he doesn't. We'll find out now. He's trying not to bite, but she's digging like a reporter, and she's digging to try and pull something out of this because she knows it's only going to have a negative output that she can then latch onto and rah, and have a little cry about. What Tupac's saying, he's looking for the good in this. He's saying that this director, and I'm guessing it's the director or the producer, picked four young black males. Not what he's, did he say kind of black or something? Can't remember the term that he used. Actual raw, okay, from the ghetto, and he done that, and he gave him a chance, gave him a spotlight, and gave him a movie. That's what he's saying the message is. He's saying, fuck the story message. That's not the point here, which I've heard is a really good film anyway, but he's saying it's not the fucking point. The point is that four young black males were in a film. That's what he's trying to say.
Start somewhere. And I don't know about anything else, but this, to me, was the start.
What was the message, though?
The message... That's like I'm telling you, I can't think from earnest. But my message was that the young black male can accomplish anything. Me,
good
Tupac,
you,
Red Cold Turkey, got well done, the part,
man.
Did the movie.
Okay. Good for you.
And didn't blink.
Okay, we're going to take a break. We'll continue with our guests right after this.
That's because you didn't get what you wanted. I've changed my fucking mind about you. Ah, man, they're all the same, ain't they? They're all the fucking same. Make sure that when I start interviewing people, which is going to happen, okay, that I don't become these fucking bell ends. If I do, please comment section and slap the fuck out of me to... Like, no. Literally, you know, like a dog with a rolled up newspaper just fucking on my nose and be like, no, Hector. No. Stop that. Because it's ridiculous what they're doing there. And I'm so glad he sideswiped it. I'm not shocked that he sideswiped it. I'm not shocked, but it's still frustrating to watch.
Okay.
And didn't blink.
Okay. We're going to take a break. We'll continue with our guests right after this.
I liked her.
Continue with Tupac.
Yes.
That was, no, which one was that?
Trapped. They got me trapped.
You know.
That's my first one.
We have seen what they did to Rodney King. The whole world has seen what happened to Rodney King.
Hold up. Baby, let me show you what they did to Tupac Shakur.
Right.
All that movie, that didn't mean nothing to OPD.
Right.
I was still a N-I-double-G-A.
Uh-huh.
And they proved it. And if you can see this, Mr. Cameraman, all of this is scars I'll go to my grave with.
I can
These
see
are
it.
Learn to be a nigga scars.
Who did that to you?
Oakland Police Department. All above my eye, all of that.
Exactly.
And I pay their salaries. Because I was an outspoken young black man. They were sweating me for jaywalking.
You were jaywalking and they stopped you?
And I swear to you, I don't even know what jaywalking is. Didn't until they beat me down for it. They stopped me. They asked me for my ID. My real name is Tupac Shakur. There's nothing fake about me. There's no stage name or stage aura. That's my name. And that's how I said it. My name is Tupac Shakur. Just because my name wasn't John Brown, it irked them. So they started, you know, saying, well, what your mother name you that for? Blah, blah. So I got hot. That was beyond the call of duty. So I was like, give me my citation. Let me go about my business. And I said the words that NWA made famous. So that got him too high. He couldn't stand to see a young black male tell him. So they put their hands on him.
Okay, so I, this is where I'm going to just... I'm listening to all of them. So I listened to the Tupac interview with the Black Panthers, with the new... No. The new African, Black African Party. Panther, Black African... Oh, fucking hell, I can't believe I can't remember it. I was listening to about African names being changed. So this is where I can see that passion in his name, where he said about, you know, his name Tupac Shakur, and he even said it during that interview that rocks the boat a bit. So he is using his African name as opposed to the Joes and the Johns that were given as slave names. And again, if I've got that right, I'm trying to educate from that have been passed through generations, that was given as part of the slave trade. You were given your Joes, your Johns, your Bobs, your this, that, and the other, and that's just obviously generationally carried on. What he's saying is that he used his name Tupac, and then suddenly they started attacking that, and then he's got to defend himself by saying the fact that, you know, oh yeah, I did get a bit hot-headed. Fucking right and all, mate. That's like me saying my name and someone laughing at it to go, what, you might pick Mark? I'd be like, oh, fuck yourself. And he said, I NWA'd that. Yeah, you said fuck the police is what you said. I'm fully aware of what you said, Tupac. You should have just said it. But you know, anyone's mocking your name, you know, that's your fucking name. And you're meant to be a police officer giving me citation for jaywalking, whatever the fuck that means, and let the man just walk away. But no, they had to dig. And then suddenly he's on the receiving end of that. Ah, racist acts.
Call of Duty. So yeah. I was like, give me my citation. Let me go about my business.
Rightly
so. And
Simon.
I said the words that NWA made famous.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So that got him too high. He couldn't stand to see a young black male tell him. So they put their hands on him.
You're suing them.
10 mil.
We'll see
what else
happens.
Can I do? You know, yeah. We'll see what happens. You know how that go.
Yeah.
Rodney King's still fighting for his, and they got it on tape.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? They got it on tape.
So when we see, you know, this video, Trapped,
yes,
it's coming from inside.
Everything I ever say, whether it's good or bad, it's coming from my heart.
Yes.
And if it's wrong, then, you know, God ain't finished with me yet. Let him check me. You know what I'm saying? But I'm going to say it as it comes from my heart, because that's what we need. Obviously, when, you know, I seen all of that. I seen the crack babies, all of that. So nothing America can show me, nothing these critics, nothing, nobody can show me, can back me down.
Are you bitter? Are you angry?
Good question.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I am. I am angry because I'm angry for my mother, because she gave up a lot of her life for this. I'm angry for Fred Hampton's family, because they lost a straight up soldier. And, you know, here we are still killing each other.
You have a list of titles, and I want you to give me just a little bit of an idea of where these things come from and what you think about when you come up with these. First one, I don't give a F. Violent.
Yes,
words of wisdom. Something wicked. Crooked ass nigga.
I've done.
If my homie calls,
mm-hmm.
Brenda's got
so
a baby.
Far.
We saw
that.
The lunatic. Rebel of the underground. And part-time
that.
Mother.
Yeah.
Those are the titles of your rap songs.
Those that represents 20 years on this planet Earth, and what I've seen, this is my report. Like if I was John Johnson, I'm back with my report. Here's what I got.
That's an amazing line. These are 20 years of my life, and if I'm John Johnson, I'm back with my report. So it's almost like that whole news reporting of his 20 years of life in one album, which is the one that I bought the other day. So I'm just saying, still sealed, which I won't open it at all, because I'm weird like that. But it's just exciting when she showed the back. I was like, I've seen
John Johnson, I'm back with my report. Here's what I got.
Let's pick Violent. No, let's pick Words of Wisdom. Let's pick Words of Wisdom.
I haven't listened to it. Don't ruin it.
It's an old song. I had it a long time ago.
You can ruin it.
It's like my battle cry to America. They think because I was doing a lot of songs that was like, you know, against the police or like a lot of gangster songs. So I wanted to show that you could be a gangster and have gangster lyrics, but know who your enemy was. And I pointed out my enemy. And I totally denounced the Statue of Liberty. Because it's false. It's a, you know, a contradiction.
What do you think, you know, we sit here and we're talking, and you're obviously a very intelligent young man. I know you dropped out of school.
Yeah.
You're actually homeless.
Yeah.
At one point.
I still don't have a high school diploma. They didn't, to me, if you let America tell it, I'm ignorant. I'm an ignorant black male. And that's what my point is to constantly, by day to day, showing how we get the short end of the stick. We get stereotyped and stuck in boxes.
But we have always, as African Americans, known that education was sort of the key to us. I mean, you know, you talked about Spike and...
No, but it depends on what you're being educated, love. So, So even I know things like I was never taught about Malcolm X, Martin Luther King. I never heard about Black Panthers. I never heard about the COINTEL. I never heard these things. You know, as we were learning the history of every country and where we came from. But they were quick to throw the fucking Bible at my head, though, weren't they? Quick to show me that fucking stuff, but not reality of the situation. So I get what she's about to say. I dropped out of school at 14, 15, maybe an earlier than that, I don't remember. I never finished education. And that was probably the best thing that ever happened, because what was I being educated? Math was probably about the best thing I can take from that. English, so I could read. That's interesting. But at least then I can choose what I'm reading, like now. This woman's starting to frustrate me now. She really is, because...
Easily a very intelligent young man. I know you dropped out of school.
Yeah.
You're actually homeless
Homeless. I still don't have a high school diploma. They didn't... to me, if you let America tell it, I'm ignorant. I'm an ignorant black male. And that's what my point is to constantly, by day-to-day, showing how we get the short end of the stick. We get stereotyped and stuck in boxes.
But we have always, as African Americans, known that education was sort of the key to us. I mean, you know, you talked about Spike and Arsenio and all these guys, but the reality is that they are out there negotiating these multi-million dollar deals. And maybe they're helping themselves out a lot, but they're able to do that.
That's why...
Is Tupac able to do that? Are you going to be in a position to do that?
Yeah. Yes, because not only... And I could do it for myself, but I would rather have... I want to hire, you know what I'm saying, black folks that know how to do that. That's why I want them to go to school. I don't want them to go to school to be a basketball player. You know, why? Well, you shouldn't be in school if you got a scholarship for basketball.
Right.
There's a lot more than sports.
Gang of basketball players. Right.
And we getting a lot of dough and a lot of money, but no respect. And that's for centuries we had a gang of rich basketball players and a gang of rich entertainers.
I like you a lot. We'll be right back and we're going to talk about Tupac's company. Stay with us.
They just can't stand the rain or the occasional pain from a man like...
As we continue with Tupac Shakur, and we don't have a lot of time left, but wanted to mention the Digital Underground is still going strong, you guys.
Oh, yes. Everybody's like, you quit Digital Underground. I'm still very much a part of the Digital Underground. That's what this is all about.
Yes.
Continuing to work.
Keeping it going. And the Underground Railroad, which is your company?
My production company.
Yes.
Same principles as Harry Tubman. Reach from here and bring to here. Legit. You know what I'm saying? We're coming. All the people you threw away, the dope dealers and the criminals, they will be legit sitting next to you in first class, thanks to your boy.
Okay. Well, we're going to get up there to see you sometime in Oakland. You come back down and visit us anytime.
Come on down and see me now, yeah?
Yeah. Continued success,
I sure
Tupac.
Appreciate it.
And
thank
God
you.
Bless you.
He's so sweet,
you're a very special young man.
I appreciate that.
Okay. That's it for this edition of our program. We'll see all of you the next time, and you take care of yourself, everybody. Bye-bye.
Okay. Whew. That interview was a fucking roller coaster, because then I liked her at the end and then I felt bad because now I picture her watching this and listening to me waffle on. Listen, okay, I'm not a horrible person, just people frustrate me sometimes when they ask stupid questions. Or they don't let Tupac speak. That's all I'm saying, when they don't let him speak. So all this does is reconfirm for me how fucking amazing this dude is, because his ability and the way he's talking there, even how he dodged the question he knew was a plot to start digging into black people shooting each other as part of a movie. How's that a different message to what you've just been attacking now, etc., etc., etc.? He just kept on it and like, yeah, but that's not what I'm saying. You're asking me what's the good that comes of this. The good is the reality, not the fucking made up film, not that. Not the movie. The reality of the situation is what he was taking pride in. And I think that speaks volumes about Tupac at fucking 20. That's mad. All that's made me want to do is to jump into this Tupacalypse now, which I'm going to. Obviously, we're going to do that as part of the Tupac journey. But yeah, I enjoyed that a lot. Comment section, let me know what you feel about that. Tell me if you make it this far. It's always good to read comments of people that make it all the way through the interview. Anything else that I can think of? No, you're all beautiful. You are sexy bastards. Like, it's just every day I'm like, ooh, damn.